So, dear students, in today's lecture, we are going to discuss that how did the Indian freedom movement progress when the world was engulfed in First World War. So, please remember, this is the time when Mahatma Gandhi has not yet appeared on the political scene of India. And Congress is divided into two factions. One is of the moderate faction. Moderate means they do not believe in violence or extremist policies, and they believe that Britishers are sympathetic towards Indians, whereas the other faction is of extremist leaders, extremist who believes that Britishers should be removed with the use of force, with the use of violence. So let us see what were the major events and how did the political movement progress during World War I. So Gadar Party was a prominent party that got formed just before the beginning of First World War, because world wars do not begin all of a sudden. So people had some idea that some large scale war is about to take place in Europe. So if a war takes place in Europe and Britain is involved in that war, it means that Britain will be weakened. Britain is involved in war. So it is the right time for Indians to try to throw Britishers out of India. So with all these things in view, Gadar Party was created. The Gadar Party was an international political movement which mainly involved Indians living abroad. So please mind you, this was a political party formed not in India, but it was meant for Indians who were working or who were living in European countries and American countries. So basically, Gadar Party was more active in America, USA. Why? Because USA was sympathetic towards India. The Gadar Party was formed on 15th July 1913 in United States, USA, America, under the leadership of Lala Hardayal. Very important. Who formed the Gadar Party? Lala Hardayal, with Sohan Singh Bhakna as its president. So who was the founder? Lala Hardayal. Who was the first president? Sohan Singh Bhakna. The party had its headquarters at San Francisco, named Yugantar Ashram. So San Francisco is a city in the US. So this was a party formed not in India, but in USA, but it was fighting for Indian independence only, and it was led and supported by Indians. So the headquarters was at San Francisco, and the headquarters was named Yugantar Ashram. The Gadar Party found a large support base among Indian expatriates. Expatriates means Indians who are temporarily living in different countries because of maybe work or because of studies. So it became very popular among Indian expatriates who were living in United States, Canada, East Africa and Asia. So upon the outbreak of the First World War in 1914, some members of the Gadar Party arrived in Punjab, because as soon as World War I started, so they thought that this is the right time to try to dislodge, to try to remove the British Raj from India. So that's why they were living abroad. But as soon as World War began, they went to Punjab, because mostly they were Sikhs. This Gadar Party was, the control of the Gadar Party was with Sikhs. So that's why they came back to Punjab to foment an armed revolution. So they were not, you know, believers of non-violence. So they thought that if you have to defeat Britishers, you will have to employ violence. So their aim or ambition was to create an armed revolution in India. So they were also successful in smuggling arms and inciting the Indian soldiers in British army to mutiny. So you can see ही इज द प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ गदर पार्टी सोहन सिंह भाकना. ऑल दीज लीडर्स वेर वेरी सून अरेस्टेड. सो दे हैड कम टू पंजाब बिकॉज दे वॉन्टेड टू क्रिएट एन आर्म स्ट्रगल. सो गदर पार्टी कंटिन्यूड देयर फाइट अगेंस्ट कोलोनियलिज्म फ्रॉम 1914 टू 1917. दैट मीन्स ड्यूरिंग द ड्यूरेशन व्हेन वर्ल्ड वॉर वॉज गोइंग ऑन. द पार्टी वॉज बिल्ट अराउंड द वीकली न्यूज पेपर कॉल्ड द गदर. The name of the party was also Gadar, and they published a weekly newspaper which was named after the name of the party, the Gadar, which carried the caption on the masthead, Angreji Raj ka Dushman, that means an enemy to British rule. So the newspaper they used to print, the front line used to be Angreji Raj ka Dushman, that means enemies of British Raj. Gadar party was a source of inspiration for many revolutionaries of the freedom struggle. So most notable among them was Bhagat Singh. That means this party was very much operational in Punjab, and Bhagat Singh was also a Punjabi Sikh. He was so that's why this party is responsible for creating mass awareness, mass political awareness in Punjab. The next major significant event was the Komagata Maru incident. So Komagata Maru was actually a Japanese ship, steamship, passenger ship. So what was this incident? In the year 1914, it was carrying 376 passengers from Punjab to Canada. So why these passengers wanted to go to Canada? Because Canada was also under control of British. Fine. So in Canada, the British have kept their army. British army was present in Canada in large number. So that army comprised of lakhs and lakhs of Sikh. So Sikh people were sent to Canada in form of army people. And later on, their family members also went to Canada. So today you can see that there is a large amount of, you know, Punjabi population living in Canada. So all this began during this time only because World War is going on. So British sent the Punjabi soldiers to Canada, and that's why their family members also wanted to go to Canada. So this ship Komagata Maru was carrying 370 Punjabis, you can openly say Punjabis, to Canada. So only 24 passengers were admitted to Canada. The other 352 passengers were forcefully returned to India because World War was going on. And it was said that we will allow only British citizens to come here. So the logic given by these Punjabi passengers was that India is also under control of British. So we are also British citizens. But Canadian authorities did not agree. They did not allow them to enter into Canada. So the ship was forcefully returned. So this ship was forcefully returned back to India. So the Sikhs of Punjab, they took this as an insult. Why this was an insult by British? Because you take our sons as soldiers to Canada, but their family members, their father, mother can't go to Canada. So it was obviously an insult. The ship returned to Calcutta in September of 1914. So ship was returned and the passengers were asked that now get out of the ship. Now we have reached India. So the ship was harbored at Calcutta and they were asked to come out of the ship. But they refused. They refused to come out of the ship. And that's why the British police fired at them. Fired so that they must all come out of the ship. So in this fire, 22 people died. So if this will happen, then think about the sentiments of Punjab. So Punjab was already feeling insulted. Now 22 people have been killed by British police. So the emotions ignited after this incident was voiced by Indian revolutionaries, particularly the Gadar party members. So Gadar party got an excuse, or you can say got an opportunity to, you know, further their agenda in Punjab. So you have to remember what was Komagata Maru incident. Where was the ship going to? Canada. It was a Japanese ship. So all these are major points. When did this event take place? The beginning of World War, 1914. So many meetings were held in California in 1914 by Gadarites. Why in California? Because they were more active in US. Their headquarters was at San Francisco. So that's why there were many meetings at California. So now World War One begins. So in First World War lasted for 5 years. Britain allied with France, Russia, USA, Italy, and Japan. So on one side were these countries. On the other side was Germany, Austria, Hungary, and Turkey. So war started. So as soon as war started, Indian politicians and common people of India began to think that what should our response be? It is not our war. We are not participating in World War One. Then how should we respond? So there were basically three types of opinions. So moderates means those people who did not want to use violence and who had some kind of sympathy for British Raj. So these moderates supported the empire in the war because they were sympathetic towards British Raj, because they thought that this is our duty, because we are also part of British Commonwealth. So if Britain is fighting, so we become duty bound to help them. The other group was of extremists. So extremist leader was Tilak. So he was released in June 1914. Why was he released in June 1914? Because he was in jail from 1908 to 1914. Where was he jailed? In Mandalay, Burma. So Tilak was of the opinion that let's support, even the extremist said at the beginning that let's support the British, because they were thinking that once the World War is over, the British will give us some kind of power to rule ourselves, because if we help the British, they will return the favor. So what were the revolutionaries thinking? Revolutionaries means those who have militant tendency, those who do not use to hesitate guns against British Raj. So revolutionaries decided to wage a war and liberate the country. So these three were three types of opinions. Revolutionary activity was carried out through the Gadar Party in North America, Berlin Committee in Europe, and some scattered mutinies by Indian soldiers, such as the one in Singapore. So the ambition of Gadar Party was to somehow create an armed rebellion. That means no rally, no protest, no mass movements, but simply use guns against guns. So what they used to do, these Gadar Party people used to do, they used to, go and talk to Indian soldiers and they used to ask them to revolt. So the next major political development was Home Rule League movement. Now understand this scenario. World War One has already started. Major section of Indian society is supporting the British government. Some, groups like Gadar Party and revolutionaries, they are planning to launch an, you can say, armed rebellion against British. So under this circumstances, a new kind of movement was launched, which was known as Home Rule Movement. So what was this Home Rule Movement? So this is the flag of Indian Home Rule Movement. So Union Jack. So this is the flag of Britain. So basically Home Rule meant that we don't want to separate from Britain, but we want more powers for Indians to rule themselves. So what was Home Rule Movement? The Indian Home Rule Movement was a movement in British India on the lines of Irish Home Rule Movement. But what was this? So for the Irish, Home Rule meant that they would be governed by a domestic parliament in Ireland and not by the British Parliament in London. So same was happening with India also. All the laws were passed in British Parliament. They were not discussing anything with Indian people. So it was like behaving like slaves. So Indians were like slaves to British people. Their opinion was never sought. So this home rule movement was actually started in Ireland. So Ireland was also, Ireland is the neighbor of Britain. So same, Britain have also captured Ireland. So in Ireland, they were demanding that give us the power to create our own parliament. So same demand was, you know, you can say, enlabbed by Indians, labbed by Indians, and they also started to demand home rule for India as well. So in India, the movement lasted around 2 years between 1916 and 1918 under the leadership of Annie Besant and Bal Gangadhar Tilak. So in 1921, All India Home Rule League changed its name to Swaraj Sabha. So Home Rule basically means Swaraj. So these two were the leaders of Home Rule movement. She is Annie Besant and he is Bal Gangadhar Tilak. So what were their roles and why did they start Home Rule movement? The Government of India Act, which is also known as Minto Morley reforms. So they failed to satisfy the nationalists. Why? Because the nationalists wanted dominion status, some kind of self-rule, but that was not given to them. And Tilak was released from the jail. So Tilak was imprisoned in Mandalay jail since 1908. The absence of Congress leaders led to the rise in stature of Annie Besant. So Annie Besant was an Irish lady. So in Ireland, she was from Ireland, and it was in Ireland from where the Home Rule League movement had begun. So she brought the same idea to India. And that's why she became the leader of Indian Home Rule movement. She is not the leader of Irish Home Rule movement. She was just a supporter of Irish Home Rule movement. But she used to live in India. She used to live in Madras. Her home was in Madras. So finally, Tilak was released in 1914. So by 1915, many factors set the stage for new phase of nationalist movement. Because when Tilak was released from prison, the extremist group became very happy that our leader has come back after 6 years. So they were mentally prepared that now Tilak is there to provide leadership, because that time Tilak was the tallest leader of Congress when he was released. So they were ready to ask Tilak to do some kind of mass movement. So general sentiment was that moderates and extremists should resolve their differences. So as I already told you that Congress was divided into two different factions of moderates and extremists. So the people of India wanted that, why don't you two groups come together? So you have to remember that in 1907 at Congress session of Surat, these two groups, moderates and extremists, have separated. So moderates have expelled extremist leaders from Congress. So extremist leaders like Bal Gangadhar Tilak, Vipin Chandra Pal, Lala Lajpat Rai, they were expelled in 1907 from Congress. So technically Bal Gangadhar Tilak was not a member of Congress when he was released from the jail. So you can see Annie Besant here. Can you identify this person? Let us see who this person is. So Annie Besant had started the New India newspaper and was the leader of Theosophical Society. So what were her credentials as a politician? So why would people of India believe her? Why would they trust her? She's not an Indian. But she built trust by starting a newspaper called New India. So in that newspaper, she used to demand home rule for India. That is how her stature increased. People began to respect her. And she was also the leader of Theosophical Society. The headquarter of Theosophical Society was at Madras, and she was also living in Madras. All this newspaper was also started at Madras. So through her newspaper, she demanded self-rule for Ireland and India. So in 1916, when the war was at peak, prominent Indian leaders, Jinnah, he is Muhammad Ali Jinnah, prominent Indian leaders Jinnah, Tilak, Satyendranath Bose and Annie Besant decided to organize leagues all across India to demand home rule, because the same movement was already going on in Ireland. So now they wanted the same to happen in India. So Tilak was out of jail, Annie Besant was already demanding home rule. So all these leaders meet. Who was Muhammad Ali Jinnah? Why did he become famous? So Muhammad Ali Jinnah, before becoming famous, was the lawyer of Tilak. Because Tilak was sent to jail in 1908. So Tilak, he was Tilak's lawyer. He had fought that case. And that is how slowly, gradually he became famous. Later on, Muhammad Ali Jinnah joined the Muslim League. So he joined the Muslim League in 1913. So Jinnah, Tilak, Annie Besant, Satyendranath Bose, they held a meeting and they decided that let's start home rule movement. So basically home rule movement is self-government within the British Empire. Within the British Empire. So if you see this map, so that's why they were not asking for complete freedom. So within the British Empire. So now decision was already taken that Indians are going to start home rule movement. So Tilak found the first home rule league. So Tilak was the first person who established home rule league, and his home rule league had its headquarters at Bombay. So Tilak started the first home rule league at Bombay Provincial Congress at Belgaum in April 1916. So Belgaum is in Karnataka. So in that session, he announced that I would be starting a home rule league at Bombay, because he was himself a citizen of Bombay Presidency. So after this, Annie Besant founded the second league at Adyar, Madras in September 1916. So there were two leagues. One was formed in April, the other was formed in September. Both were formed in 1916. So first league was formed by Tilak. The second league was formed by Annie Besant. So Tilak's league and Annie Besant's league, two leagues. That's why formation of two leagues. So while Tilak's league worked in areas like Maharashtra, excluding Bombay city, Karnataka, Central Provinces and Berar. Annie Besant's league worked in rest of India. So two leagues, both have their different operation areas. So Tilak's league, mostly Maharashtra, Karnataka, Central Province, that means Madhya Pradesh. Annie Besant's league, rest of India. The members of Servants of India Society were not allowed to join the movement. Why were the Servants of Indian Society not allowed to join the movement? See, the reason was Servants of India Society was founded by Gopal Krishna Gokhale. So Gopal Krishna Gokhale was a moderate leader. He was moderate. Tilak was extremist. So Gopal Krishna Gokhale had expelled Tilak in 1906. So there was an old rivalry. Also, when Tilak had approached Congress for help regarding establishing the Home Rule League, they have denied any kind of help. because they said that World War I is going on, let's not create any problems for British people. So that's why Tilak had some kind of resentment. So that's why Servants of India Society were not allowed. The move created considerable excitement at the time and attracted many members of the Congress and Muslim League. So Congress members were allowed, but Servants of India Society, that means particularly followers of Gokhale, were not allowed. Also Muslim League was allowed. Why? Because Jinnah was also one of the leaders who was leading the Home Rule movement. So what was this league doing? So they were going to different parts of the countries. They used to give speeches, fiery speeches, petitions with hundreds and thousands of Indians as signatories. So they used to collect signatures from Indian citizens and they used to put their demands before the British administration. So what was the impact of Home Rule movement? Many moderate leaders like Muhammad Ali Jinnah joined the movement. The credit for bringing two different groups of moderates and extremists. So you can see that problem is there with between Gokhale and Tilak. So the credit for bringing two different groups of moderates and extremists, Congress and Muslim League together, goes to Annie Besant. So moderates and extremists, they have already split in Surat session of 1907, and Congress and Muslim League were also not were of different opinions. So but now the demand of Home Rule League movement, or the demand of the hour, was that everybody should come together. They must forget their political differences and they must come together. So they were brought together by the efforts of Annie Besant. The government arrested Annie Besant in 1917 and this led to nationwide protest. The league spread political awareness in new areas like Sindh, Punjab, Gujarat, United Provinces, Central Provinces, Bihar, Odisha and Madras. So political awareness, because before this, up till now, India has not seen any all India level movement. There was a movement in Bengal in 1906 after the partition of Bengal. But now political awareness, that means the tendency that Indian people should come out on streets and fight the British government. So this is the first movement that is giving Indians the opportunity. So political awareness was spread in new areas other than Bengal. The pressure of the movement, especially after Annie Besant's arrest, led to the Montague's declaration on 20th August 1917. What was Home Rule movement? They were demanding self-rule. World War I is going on. British need the support of Indian people. So there was a lot of pressure on British government, and this pressure resulted in the declaration of Montague's declaration, which was made in 28th August 1917. So we will see what was Montague's declaration. We will see. So Montague Chelmsford reforms was a British promise towards development of a responsible government in India. So basically the British were trying to convince the Indian people that we are soon going to bring a large scale reform. So you people want home rule. So we will bring reforms so that some kind of power should be given to Indians as well. So this was promised in 1917. Home rule movement is still at its peak. So let's see, how did the Home Rule movement subside? How did it come to an end? The movement was left leaderless once Tilak left for England to pursue a legal case. Actually, some English newspaper, they have written some rubbish against Bal Gangadhar Tilak, very insulting things about Bal Gangadhar Tilak. So Tilak had filed a defamation case in London. So to fight that case, he have to go out of the country. So Tilak was the leader of one of the leagues. Two leagues were there. One was of Tilak, the other was of Annie Besant. So now Tilak has gone out of country. So who will take care of his league? And Annie Besant was largely satisfied by the promise of reforms. Which reforms? Montague, Chelmsford reforms, because they have already promised that, okay, please wait. We are soon going to bring reforms. So its further growth and activity were stalled by the rise of Mahatma Gandhi and his Satyagraha art of revolution. So Mahatma Gandhi came back to India in 1915. And you know that in 1917, he started Champaran Satyagraha. So people of India have got a new leader in Mahatma Gandhi, and Mahatma Gandhi have brought different kind of politics to India. He have brought the politics of Satyagraha. So people were divided in their opinion. They wanted, you know, that let's try this different kind of strategy, this Satyagraha thing. So they lost interest in agitation rallies. Gandhiji's victories in leading the farmers of Champaran, Kheda, Champaran Bihar and Kheda Gujarat against the British authorities on tax revolts made him a national hero. So after these two Satyagrahas, so Champaran Satyagraha 1917, Satyagraha of Kheda 1918, we will study in detail. So after these two successful Satyagrahas, Gandhiji had become the tallest leader. After the Montague declaration, the league agreed to suspend its expansion of the movement, because Montague have already told that, okay, please wait, please stop this movement. We are going to bring about reforms. So that is how Home Rule movement slowly gradually came to an end. The league believed that the British government will gradually reform the administration and local representative system by ushering participation of local Indians. So this is the meaning of self-rule, participation of local Indians in ruling their own country. So Montague said, okay, you want this, we will give you this. So that is what the league believed, and it stopped its movement. So if movement is stopped, so you have two leagues. Leagues means political party. So if the movement is stopped, what will these political parties do now? So in 1920, the All India Home Rule League merged with Congress, which elected Mahatma Gandhi as its president. Not the president of Congress, but the president of All India Home Rule League. So who became the president of All India Home Rule League in 1920? It is a tricky question. Most people answer Bal Gangadhar Tilak. No, it is Mahatma Gandhi. After the merger, Mahatma Gandhi became the president of All India Home Rule League. Several leaders of Home Rule movement played an important role in the national movement when it entered a truly mass movement phase under the leadership of Gandhi. So now Gandhi have absorbed all the volunteers of Home Rule League, and these people who were earlier part of Home Rule League, they now consider Mahatma Gandhi as their new leader. And Home Rule League have played a great role in establishing the credentials of Mahatma Gandhi as a politician. So everything is going fine. So now the one more major event that took place during World War I was the Lucknow Pact. What was the Lucknow Pact? The Lucknow Pact was an agreement between the Congress and the Muslim League. So it was an agreement, because Congress and Muslim League, they always used to have difference of opinion. But when a movement is going on, when Home Rule movement is going on, so it was thought that all the political parties should give up their differences and should come together. So that was the Lucknow Pact, where Congress and Muslim League joined hands. They agreed to jointly, you know, participate in the Home Rule movement. The pact enhanced the League's power in Indian politics. Jinnah was then a member of both the parties and he was largely responsible for the pact. So Muhammad Ali Jinnah was member of Congress as well as of Muslim League. So he played an active role in bringing these two political parties together. So this was the first time that Indian National Congress and Muslim League was meeting for a joint session. You must remember that this session was headed by Annie Besant. Annie Besant, she was the one who had convinced Muslim League and Congress to come together. And Annie Besant had also convinced extremists and moderates also to come together. So two great events happened at Lucknow, which is known as Lucknow Pact. Congress and Muslim League joined hands, whereas the moderate and extremist faction of Congress also joined hands. So it was unity, unity, friendship, friendship all over. So the Lucknow Pact also helped in establishing cordial relations between the extremist factions led by Lal Bal Pal, Lala Lajpat Rai, Bal Gangadhar Tilak and Bipin Chandrapal, and the moderate faction led by Gopal Krishna Gokhale. The Lucknow Pact was an agreement between the Congress and Muslim League reached a joint session held at Lucknow in 1916. So what happened here? The leaders, because two parties have merged hands, Congress and Muslim League, they have merged hands, they have come together. So the leaders jointly drafted a set of demands for constitutional reforms. A memorandum was submitted to the Viceroy seeking reforms. What kind of reforms? Self-rule, give us power to rule ourselves. Let Indians rule India. Finally, at their respective annual sessions held at Lucknow in December 1916, the Indian National Congress and League confirmed the agreement. So this agreement is today known as Lucknow Pact. So when did this happen? In 1916. For his efforts, Sarojini Naidu gave Jinnah the title of Ambassador of Hindu-Muslim Unity. So today it might appear funny because Jinnah is considered responsible for partition of India on religious ground. But during his young days, he was not in favor of partition. And it was Jinnah. Jinnah was member of both Congress and Muslim League. And Jinnah had played a great role in allowing the Lucknow Pact to take shape. So that's why, remember the fact, Sarojini Naidu had given the title to Jinnah, the Ambassador of Hindu-Muslim Unity. So Home Rule movement has almost come to an end because they are demanding self-rule, and Montague has declared that okay, wait, we are going to bring about reforms. So this declaration is known as August Declaration. So Edwin Montague, who was the Secretary of State for India, he was critical of the manner in which India was governed. That means he was sympathetic. So this is British Parliament of that time. So he was sympathetic towards the Indian population. So he said that, okay, if they are asking for reforms, so let's give them some kind of self-rule. Let's give them some kind of reforms. So on 20th August 1917, Montague presented the historic Montague Declaration in British Parliament. The Home Rule movement is going on, but it has lost its pace. This declaration proposed the increased participation, self-rule. So this is not exactly self-rule, but from now on, Indian will also have an opportunity to become part of government. Earlier only British people are deciding that also in British Parliament. They are deciding what rules, what laws have to be enacted in India without discussing with Indians. So the declaration proposed the increased participation of Indians in the administration and development of self-governing institutions in India. So the outcome of this declaration was Montford Report. So Montague visited India and held talks with Indians. So Montague held meetings with different government and non-government people of India. He, along with the Governor General of India, Lord Chelmsford, that's why it is called Ford. Ford from Chelmsford, Mont from Montagu. So Montagu came to India and he started taking feedback of different political groups as well as his own British officers. So these two people were leading the talks, Mont and Ford. Mont means Montagu, Ford means Lord Chelmsford. So they were leading these discussions. So these two people, after having lots of discussion, brought out a detailed report which was titled Constitutional Reforms in India, which is also called Montague Chelmsford Report. It was just a report submitted in British Parliament that we went to India, we talked to so and so people and this is their feedback. So this report was published on 8th July 1918. So this report became the basis for the Government of India Act 1919, which is also known as Montague Chelmsford Reforms. These two people, Montague and Chelmsford Reforms, or Montford Reforms. So what was this Montford Reforms, or you can say officially it was called Government of India Act. So what was the sequence? In 1917, declaration was made that wait, we are going to bring reform. In 1918, the report was published after discussion, and in 1919, the real law is brought. So Government of India Act, what were the provisions? Provincial diarchy, the most important feature. The act provided a dual form of government, two sets of government for the major provinces. It relaxed control over provinces by demarcating subjects as central subjects and provincial subjects. So there are different subjects that a government have to take care of. For example, agriculture, railways, defense, telecommunication. So these are subjects. So earlier, all these subjects were taken care by a single government. There was a single government in center. There was only one form of government which was operating from Delhi, the capital of India. There was no government in Patna. There was no government in Lucknow. There was no government in Bombay. So now this Government of India want that it is okay that there is a government in center, but what about states? So there should be local government at state level as well. So that was the major provision. So question is asked, when was diarchy introduced in India? So diarchy was introduced in India after the bringing of Government of India Act. So these subjects were divided in two lists. So one list was under the control of central government. That means central government will decide about defense. Local or provincial government will decide about matters of agriculture. So two lists were made. That means you are giving authority to state level politicians. For the first time, introduced direct elections. So if you want government to be formed at state level, so you want Indian politicians to form that government. So if you want Indian politicians to form the government, there have to be elections. So for the first time, it introduced the concept of direct elections. So direct means people will directly choose who becomes the member of parliament. Earlier, what used to happen? People used to, not everybody was allowed to vote. Only zamindars, rich people, people who were paying taxes, only these kind of people were allowed to vote. But now the number of people who can vote is increased. So for the first time, introduced direct elections and limited franchise was granted on the basis of tax paid, education, property, etc. That means now also not everybody can vote, but there were certain criteria who can vote. Who was at least class 6 pass, who was paying some kind of tax, who had certain amount of property. That means there were criteria. The electorates were considerably enlarged to 5.5 million for the provinces and 1.5 million for the imperial legislature. Imperial means central parliament. So two things are happening. Now British have allowed Indians to form government at state level, and the British have also allowed people to choose their government, vote for their government. Establishment of unicameral provincial legislative council. So today we have Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha. So two houses, it is known as bicameral. Bicameral. So two houses at central level, but at state level only one house, lower house. So that is unicameral provincial legislative council. So that means state level, at state level there would be only one house, not two houses. The viceroy's executive council had 6 members, out of which 3 were to be Indians. So unicameral at state level, but at central level it had become bicameral. At central level there were 2 chambers. Also, the viceroy's executive council was expanded. 6 members, out of which 3 were to be Indians. So they are keeping their promise. They have said that we are going to involve Indians into the government. So now out of 6, 3 will be Indians. So that is the way to please Indians. So what was the impact of this Government of India Act? For the first time, concrete steps were taken to include more Indians in administration. So you can see out of 6, 3 were Indians. In Central Assembly also, Indians can now form their state level government. They can become politicians at state level. Elections were introduced, which brought about a political consciousness among Indians. So if elections are there, then people will discuss agendas. People will discuss that which party is good, which party is bad. So political education or political consciousness reaches from, you know, large cities to small villages. But the reforms fell short of satisfying the grievances and legitimate demands of Indian nationalists, because this is not self-rule. There is still a governor general. So you have just given us a few seats, but the entire control, the real control is still with British governor and his, you know, close aides. So that is not the real demand that Indians were making in home rule. The viceroy still had vast powers to undermine the effectiveness of the legislatures. So though you have given these kind of reforms, but governor general was the real, you can say, in charge of the government. But governor general is not an Indian. So how? This is not self-rule. Also, the franchise was very limited and narrow. So also not every Indian was allowed to vote. So not every Indian is allowed to decide what will happen in their country. So that is unfair. So it was stated in Montague Chelmsford report that a survey must be made after 10 years. So Montague Chelmsford have brought out this reform. So they said that, okay, let's wait for 10 years. So after 10 years, we will send a commission from Britain to India to study that how, what was the impact of Government of India Act. So Government of India Act was announced in 1919. So in this act, it was written that in 1929, we will send a commission from Britain to understand that how did this 10 years pass by. So this commission became Simon Commission, but it actually came in 1927 only. So we will discuss why did it come early. We will discuss in some other lecture. So this is what was the impact, or you can say scenario or aftermath of Government of India Act 1919. So why did Minto Morley reforms could not satisfy the Indian demands? Majority of Indians have made Swaraj or self-rule as their goal, though the reforms failed to satisfy Indian political opinions because the real rule was with Governor General. Indians were resentful that British would decide what was good and what was bad for Indians. Several members of the council, including Jinnah, resigned in protest because this is not what they were demanding. They were demanding self-rule, but Britishers have not given this to them. So now they are not happy. Congress was against the idea of separate electorate for each community. So what is the separate electorate? So some seats will be reserved for Muslims, some seats will be reserved for Sikhs, some seats will be reserved for Anglo-Indians, and only Muslims can vote for Muslims, only Sikhs can vote for Sikhs. So this kind of system was known as separate electorate. So this was not acceptable to Congress.